But there's still no time for chilling by the pool. Rental on the villa is racking up, so Elvis needs to get a move on recommissioning that motor.
Well, this is lovely, isn't it? I'm on a driveway in the sunshine with a mission to get this 405 back on the road. Now, I've borrowed a few bits from Vitor, things like the tarpaulin to protect the driveway so we don't lose our deposit on this place, jacks and axle stands, and I'm going to start by giving it a full brake service. You've got to remember, this car's probably not been driven in 20 years, and in that time, things can degrade and seize up. Think of it as if you hadn't moved in two decades and someone suddenly forced you to dance the Macarena. Well, you'd want to warm up first, wouldn't you? Now, the pads themselves have actually got quite a lot of meat left on them, but things like this, well, they can just deteriorate over time. You can get delamination between the brake material and the backing plate, and I can already see signs of cracking on these too. And with the discs being worn as well, it makes total sense to replace them. It may look like a family saloon, but it's actually a very fast car, so these brakes are pretty important. There's no fixed interval to say when you should change your pads and discs. It all comes down to wear and tear, which is why checking them is a key component of the MOT. So to ensure that we pass with flying colours, I've got hold of a new set for just £145. Hopefully that should keep Mike happy. Right, now the new pads are clearly a lot thicker than the worn ones that came out. And that means the gap that was left behind when the old ones came out isn't big enough to fit these in. So I need to push back the piston in the caliper to allow that to happen. Now back at home, I've got a lovely fancy set of tools to do just that, but they wouldn't fit my bag, so I'm gonna have to improvise. So what I'm gonna do is start by fitting the new discs. Then, loosely sticking one of the new pads into the caliper so that I can make the adjustment. I'm going to use a screwdriver to lever against the disc and push that piston back, but of course I don't want to damage our brand new brake disc. And so, a bit of folded up cardboard in there will allow me to lever against that and protect it. And as I put some pressure on and push that piston back, of course what it's doing is pushing fluid back through the system. So you also have to keep an eye on the brake reservoir to make sure that's not overflowing, but it's fine. And there we go. Job done. I've just got to do the other side before I can tackle the next part of the process. I hope Mike's working this hard. Right, I've changed the brakes across the front end, but what I also want to do is change the fluid in the reservoir, because of course that's been sat in there for a very long time. Now luckily, this car has a split braking system because I've only got two axle stands here. So what it means is I can change the fluid in the front end and then move on to the rear. Brake fluid can absorb moisture from the atmosphere, and if it's left too long, it can corrode the brake system from the inside. Once the liquid's been replaced, I need to ensure there's no air in the system by drawing the fluid through the brake lines. With fresh fluid in the reservoir, I'm going to use this syringe to drag that fluid all the way through the system and out through the caliper. Of course, all the while I do that, I need to make sure I keep an eye on that reservoir and make sure it's topped up. The last thing we want is for the reservoir to empty out and air to find its way in. If pockets of air were to enter the lines, then when we hit the brakes, we're only going to get a portion of the usual stopping capability. And in a car that packs as much power as this 405, that isn't going to be good. Right, there we go. That's the pads, discs and brake fluid changed. On this side at least, I've still got to change the fluid on that side and then do the rear end. But then that's one enormous tick on our job list done and a big step towards getting this car its Portuguese MOT. And I think that's going to be about it for me today too. Right, now it's slightly annoying that we've had to buy an entire lower arm just to replace the boot on this little joint on the outer end. But that's how it is, and it does mean that, given that Mike's family won, I've got two brand new bushes on the inside as well, which gives me good peace of mind. Now I've just got to fit it. Right, well, that's a couple of the MOT failures addressed, down this end at least. Still got a bit of tidying up to do and a couple more things to look at, but I'm going to carry on working through the list down at the back end. Just like the front end, the back also has a number of corroded parts. The rear lower suspension arm, springs, and the anti-roll bar drop link all need to come off and be replaced. And even after those repairs, I've still got lots more tidying up to do. Time to tackle those rusty intake pipes. And for once, it's not costing a fortune. I got this home chroming kit for £82. I've actually seen some really strong results from kits like this in the past, so I've got my fingers crossed it's going to do the trick. First job is to strip what's left of the existing chrome off and take the pipes back to bare metal. I've dissolved 1 kilogram of alkaline salts in this bucket mixed with 10 litres of hot water. Now, to de-chrome our intake pipes, I'm creating what is basically a battery. A little bit like the 12-volt battery in your car. It's got a negatively charged cathode. Now, here, that's a steel plate mounted on some copper wire. That's going to be suspended in an electrolyte. And here, that's an alkaline sodium solution. Now, it also has a positively charged anode. And in our case, that's going to be our intake pipe itself. Now, when that's suspended in the solution and we apply a positive current to it, when we get that charge perfectly right, it's going to break down the little particles of chromium on here and detach them from the metal component. The sodium solution acts like a conduit to draw those particles away from the positively charged anode to the negatively charged cathode, and we should end up with a perfectly prepared and de-chromed pipe.
I'm using copper wire to connect it all up and then suspending a bar across the top of the tank to complete the circuit. Then it's in with our intake pipe and I can turn on the power. The kit recommends 6 volts.
It's really quite fascinating and even mesmerizing watching the process happening. You can see the surface of our intake pipe just bubbling up and even the particles, the corroded bits of chrome coming off into the solution.
After a few minutes, it's time to check on the pipe. While it might not look that different, a buff and polish should hopefully show the solution's done its job.
That's come up really nicely. I can start the process of re-chroming it now.
The re-chroming starts with a bucket of deionized water.
Now, the process for chroming is slightly different. The anode now becomes this, high-purity nickel. Now, when we combine that with cobalt, which I've got in a bag over there, we get a nickel-cobalt alloy, which gives us that beautiful chrome finish. And because we're reversing the process, our intake pipe now becomes the cathode, meaning the positively charged ions flow from the anode to the cathode, allowing that chrome finish to stick.
I'm adding nickel sulfate, nickel chloride, boric acid, and cobalt sulfate to the 10 litres of deionized water. The final ingredient is a chrome brightening solution. Before, feeling a bit like Walter White, I can lower the pipe in and hope nothing blows up in my face.
So the process is now underway. There's not much to see, so I'm going to leave it to do its thing. And get a cup of tea.
10 minutes later, it's the moment of truth.
Don't quite know what to expect. Let's have a look. Oh my goodness, look at that. Oh wow, I wasn't expecting it to be that good. It looks like a brand new component. And we've got the other 5 pipes to do, of course, go through exactly the same process with them and then get them back on the car. And then I can give it a full detail and clean up and get this thing ready for its big trip down to Italy.
Click here to subscribe.